Session that was yesterday, we saw about quicksort. And in quicksort, what are the things that you need to keep in mind? These were the things that we were supposed to sort of keep in mind. Okay. First and foremost, quicksort is a basically a problem with regard to three parts. The main part is with regard to the partition. That's why it's called partition exchange sort. Okay. So you can see the entire aspect of what was the thing related to quicksort. The first thing is to make sure that you are making the key element to be right in the middle. Okay, that was the aspect with regard to quicksort, right? You are making the key element to be right at the middle so that the left part you can sort of recursively partition and merge. You can sort of the middle, and that you what you do that for that you do what is known as the partition thing. That was the important aspect which you saw yesterday. You saw even the tracing, okay? You saw even the tracing, so that should be kept in mind without any problem. First and foremost, what are the questions that may come? First question is with regard to tracing. There is one more problem also when it comes to quicksort. Probably after today's class, maybe tomorrow's class, you're going to look into that. Okay, one more tracing problem. And next thing is you need to know about the algorithms. Now, very clearly, you need to understand that there are two algorithms very particularly. What? One algorithm is with regard to partitioning the entire array. You saw the rules, everything in yesterday's class. Okay. See, again, I'm saying for those people who missed yesterday's class, please go back. You could always download the video that was recorded. Okay. See, again, I'm saying that video may be there, may not be there, you never know. So it's always a good practice that you download and keep it somewhere. Okay. Maybe after some days, if it's not there, it's not my problem, because we are sort of working on a platform that is being given by the institute, okay, the college. So if they work based on that, fine. If they don't work, can't do anything. Okay. Aptra is all fine. You know, somehow we manage it, but this is somewhere, you know, it is fully externally sourced. So make sure that if people are downloading those videos and keeping it for your own, you know, good. Okay. So what are the two algorithms you are going to write? The first algorithm, the very important algorithm, is with regard to partitioning of it. Then the very simplest of algorithm, which you have already seen with regard to merge sort, is writing an algorithm for repeatedly partitioning and merging it. The algorithm for these two. So there will be writing two algorithms for it. And most important part is with regard to the time complexity. Okay. Quicksort is a very, very important problem, because you will be having at least three or four types of problems that can happen here. All the things you should be ready. Okay. And each and every question, if however they ask, it will be easily for 8 to 10 marks. 8 to 10 marks. So that is something which you should know, which you should keep in mind. Okay. 8 to 10 marks question, neatly you need to write each and everything related to it. Okay, so related to all these things, okay, yesterday we saw the rules also. Okay, what were the rules we saw? Okay, see this, we are going to talk about key element, comparing it with I. If key element is more than I, we increment I. If key element is less than I, we stop incrementing I and we start decrementing J. Incrementing I, decrementing J. Then what we do, we exchange thing also. When do we exchange? When I exceeds J, we exchange with A low with a AJ, okay, and we exchange before that also. We exchange, okay. When we are getting both I and J things are complete, okay, we need to sort of exchange the values from whatever that is pointed from I with the values that is pointed with J, okay. The rules which you saw before that, you saw the entire thing of what is the representation of it, okay. Low is pointing to the first element, I pointing to the last element. Sorry, I is pointing to the last element, then you are, I'm talking about I, H, I, G, H, I. Then I'm talking about I and J, which are used for both partitioning and for exchanging. Okay, then you know what is the key element. The key element by default will be the first element. Okay, the first element that you look for is always the key element. Okay, so these are the things that you basically look for. Okay, so let's sort of do this. Okay, let's sort of look into this and let's write an algorithm for it. How do you write an algorithm? Okay, same thing. We are going to start with an algorithm for what? Partitioning. Okay, there are two types of algorithms. First algorithm, what we are writing as of now, is with regard to algorithm for what? Partitioning the array. Okay, so I can write the entire thing as algorithm for partitioning the array, right? So I'll write that entire thing right here. So there are two types of algorithms or two parts of an algorithm. What you are partitioning? You are partitioning an array A with two things, okay? Low and of course high. Low and high, okay? Then what is the next thing? Next thing is with regard to the purpose. What is the purpose? You need to partition the array such that the left part of the key element are always less, the right part of it is more, okay? And of course the key element should be in between, okay? So what is the purpose? I'll write it in pictorial representation of it. You need to have a key element right in the middle. Towards the left side, you need to have values that are less than the key element. Towards the right side, you need to have values that are more than the key element. That is my purpose. Okay. Next, what will be my input? My input again is a very much an unsorted array A. Okay. There is no doubt in that. It's very much an unsorted array A. Okay. Then what will be my output? Output, of course, will be what? It will not be the entire thing. Okay. You are going to talk about what? What will be my output? Output will be in such a way that I will be having a key element right in the middle. Okay, towards this side, I'll be having all the values that are less. Towards this side, I'll be having all the values that are more. Now, please keep this in mind that this is not a sorted array. Okay, till now, when we do this entire problem, this will not be sorted. Only towards this side, it will be less. Only towards this side, it will be more. But it will not be sorted. Yesterday, you saw the example for it. It will not be sorted at all. Later, when we put what is known as the merge sort technique, then it will become sorted. Okay. So please have to keep that in mind that it is not sorted. Don't write sorted under. So what is output? It's a divided array into two parts such that what? The left part of the key element are less than the key element. The elements towards the right side of the key element are greater than the key element. No doubts in that. No, should not be any doubts in that. Okay. Then we write what is known as the most important or the core part of the algorithm. Okay, so I'll start writing that. I'm not going to do anything new. Something which you already know, I'm going to write it here. Okay, first and foremost thing is, where do you think the key element is represented? The key element is represented, I told you very clearly, the first element. Okay, the first element is represented by the key element. So what is this going to happen? A of low. To know how to have that, you must know what is the first element, right? Well, you know, where do you think is the first element, everything and all. So this is what you basically look for. A of low. What is A of low? The first element. That is represented as what? A key element. Okay. Then you are going to represent the next thing is with regard to I. First, initially, where do you think it will be? It will be right here, low. Then J. Where do you think it will be? I told you very clearly, J will be one position after your high. So I plus one. Okay. So this is also the first element. And what do you think this would be? This would be last element. Okay. Last position is positive. This is with regard to the initial aspect of it. Okay. The initial aspect of it. What is the next thing? Next thing is to make sure that you are knowing the entire condition. I told you very clearly towards this side, you are going to have I. Towards this side, you are going to have J. This I value, be careful here. This I value, whatever you are seeing, should always be either less. Okay. This either value should be either less or equal to your J. One second. Less or equal to your J. If this I value becomes more, if the I value becomes more than your J, you know what needs to be done. Okay. You need to what is done as interchange the things or exchange the things. I'll not write interchange, I'll probably write exchange because that's a better word. We need to sort of exchange. So I value should be either less than or equal to your J always. Once it becomes more, we exchange things. Okay. So that's what I'm going to write it in form of a condition also now. Okay. I'm going to write it in form of a condition. So let's look into that. So first thing you need to look for here is why. What is that sound? प्लीज म्यूट योरसेल्फ ओके जयंत नाउ प्लीज म्यूट योरसेल्फ डोंट वांट एनी डिस्टरबेंस ओके नाउ लेट्स लुक इनटू दिस ओके व्हाई आई वैल्यू इज लेस देन or equal to your j. What you are trying to do, be careful here, I'm not going to do anything, okay? You know very clearly what I'm trying to do now, okay? Do, what do? You need to keep on incrementing I. How do you increment I? I is equal to I plus 1. Do, when I have do and what is the next thing, it should be while, okay? While what? While, condition is what? While the, when do you think you are going to increment I? Or else I'll show the rules again, okay? This is why, you know, you need to have a class that should 2 hours so that you can complete the entire thing in yesterday's class itself, okay? You see this? When I'm incrementing I, when the key element is greater than I. When I'm decrementing J, when the key element is less than my I, or, you know, less than my J, okay? Key element is less than J, I decrement J. Key element is greater than I increment I. Keep, be careful with regard to increment and decrement. What is the words I'm using on all, okay? So that's what I'm trying to do now. I'm going to increment I when the key element, see, that's what I'm going to write here, okay? Nothing new here. When the key element is either greater than or equal to your A of okay, when it is equal to or greater than your A of I, I'm going to increment the entire I. So what do you call this? What do you call this entire thing? Okay, increment I when key is greater. Increment I when the key value is very much greater than your I. Okay, that's not the only thing. That's not the only thing. You need to go for one more condition. What is that one more condition? Do J minus 1. So what is the meaning of this? I need to decrement J. Okay. Decrement J while key element, okay, be careful here, is less than, that's all. No equal to again. Here equal to, you took it here itself. Greater than or equal to, okay. Key element is less than your A of J. So what do you call this? This entire two steps? You are going to decrement J when key element is less than your J. Okay, the two important parts of your algorithm, two important steps of your algorithm. This is all fine. Then, when do you think you need to do something extra, right? What is that something extra? When I value, if I value, or else I'll use some other color, okay? Yeah, I'll show it in this. So that you'll probably get to know. If I value, okay? Now you can see, clearly see while, you know, this condition. While I value is less than or equal to J, you keep on doing this do while, do while. Okay? If I value, right? If I value is less than J, keep on doing this. Once you do all those two things, okay, if it is less than J, you have done both, you know, increment and decrement. What do? You exchange. Yesterday we did this, okay? We exchange what? A of I with A of J. You exchange A of I with A of J, okay? This is one way of doing. This is one part of doing it. Now, that's the end of it, right? So we are going to say end while. Okay, end while, and that's the end of it. Okay, that's the end of it. But this is only with regard to interchanging of elements such that, you know, the elements towards the left side will be less, right side will be more. But you need to send that middle element, the key element towards the middle. Okay, the key elements towards the middle. So where do you think you need to do that? That will be done at the very last part of it. Once you have done all these things, you are going to again exchange. What you are going to exchange? Be careful now. You are going to do the other type of exchange, which is nothing but you are going to exchange whatever the value that is there in A of J with A of flow. What is A of flow? A of flow is nothing but the key element. Okay, this is nothing but my key element. Keep that in mind. Okay, you are going to return this the key element. Okay, then is that anything more? No. Okay, this is how you are going to write an entire algorithm for partitioning of your array. Okay, partitioning of your array. What is becoming very important here? Very important are these two steps where you are incrementing and where you are decrementing here. You are again, you know, sort of exchanging the values that are towards left side and right side, and you are exchanging the key element. This is exchanging of key element. Okay, so there are two exchanges and there are two partitionings. Okay, two increment, one increment, one decrement, partitioning and two exchanges that are going to come. So these two things need to be kept in mind. Okay, need to be kept in mind before we sort of, you know, analyze this entire thing. Okay, but this is not the only part. Okay, this is not the only part. There is other things also to be kept in mind. What is that other thing? When we write this entire, you know, when we sort of run this algorithm, at the end, what we get? We get what is known as, I'll write it here. Okay, we get an array which looks like this. Okay, otherwise I'll write the yesterday's example itself. The array will be basically looking like this. Okay, it will be having a 42 here. Be careful here. Okay, it will be nothing but what? This is nothing but my key element. Okay. Then towards the left side, you will be having 36, 37, okay, 11, 10. Towards the right side, you will be having 72, 65, okay, then 98, 88, then again one more, 78. This is what it will be once you sort of run this array, so run this algorithm. It will not be anything more than that. It will be like this. What is the condition here? The condition is very simple. Towards the left, you have, you know, things that are smaller. Towards the right, you have things that are, you know, more. Okay, not left, it is less. This is what you are supposed to get after when you run this algorithm. So this needs to be sorted out. See this, this entire thing now needs to be sorted, right? This entire thing now needs to be sorted. When I am able to sort this side and when I am able to sort this side, what is the next thing I am going to get? And I'll be able to get what is known as a sorted array, because 42 anyway is in the middle. So to do this two sort of sortings, what I do, I write the algorithm, okay, to do the quick sort. Okay, the algorithm with regard to quick sort. How do you think this will be done? This will be done like this. 36, 37. I'll show one example. Probably you can understand now. Okay. This will be split into two parts like this. 36, 37, 11, 10. Again, two parts like this. 36, 37. This is nothing but 11 and 10. Then you know what needs to be done. Okay. Then see, now you need to put it as, one second. Yes, the screen is not, you know, sort of moving it. So probably you get to know that, you know, what is the next thing? Now you are going to sort it. Okay. Once you sort it, what is going to happen? You are going to get the entire thing, right? With regard to, so where is it? Okay. You are going to get what is known as the screen in such a way that, sorry, the value in such a way that you are going to get a sorted array. So one example you saw with regard to partitioning. The algorithm you suffer. Our job now is to make sure that we write a quick sort algorithm. Okay, quick sort algorithm, and that's what becomes very important. Okay, so let's sort of do that. Okay, let's sort of do that and let's look into that what needs to be done and all. Okay, so first part is all done. Now our job is to make sure that we move into the next part of it. What is the next part? Next part now is to write the algorithm for the quick sort of it or the merging part of it. So how do you think that would be? It will be looking through like this. Okay, algorithm, the name is itself is algorithm of quick sort. Then you are going to have an array A or else a capital A. Then you will be having a low value, you will be having a high value. Okay, then what is the purpose? The purpose is to make sure that you are able to get a sorted array. Sorted array, okay, using quick sort technique. What is my input? Input you saw very clearly, okay. What was the input in the previous step? The previous step input was to make sure that you are going to get, okay, you are going to get that entire, the array that was given, right? So what was the input? The input is in such a way that you are having a key element in middle. Towards the left side, you have the elements which are less. Towards the right side, you have elements which are more or greater. This is my input. What will be my output? Output array A, which is sorted. There in the next, in the last step, we never took that A is sorted. Here we are going to write that A is a sorted array. Okay, A is a sorted array. So that's how you're going to do it. How you're going to do it? You know very clearly what was the example I took. The example, so I can write the example first here, then I'll write the algorithm, continue example, right? So what was the example? The example was 42 was in between. Towards the left side, you had 36, 37, 11, and 10. Towards the right side, you had 72, 65, 98, 88, and 78. You can clearly see this was my key element. And what was my key element? The key element was 42. Okay. Now I need to sort the left hand side. I need to sort the right hand side. Okay. That's what we need to do. So for this, I'm going to write an algorithm. How? Again, a very simple way of writing algorithm. Not much complications here. It's something which you already know. Okay. So I'll start writing that. How it's going to write? Very simple. First, where do you think this would be? This will be representing my low. Obviously, this one will be representing my high. Okay. Then, how are you going to write it? Okay. If low value is less than my high value. Is that correct? Yeah, it's very much correct. Low value is less than my high value. It will be correct because the mid element is here. So, anything towards this side will be more. Anything towards this side will be less. So, it will be true only. Okay, I am going to assign the mid value. What is the mid value? This is something which you already know. Okay, mid value of partitioning the entire aspect of it. Partitioning, this is an algorithm called for the previous algorithm which you saw. Okay, which will be having A, low and high. And how we are going to do it? I am going to keep on doing that recursively. Please understand this. I'm going to keep on doing this recursively. The left part. What is the left part? A. Okay. Starts from where? Low. Till here. Till where? Till your mid. Okay. Minus one. Be careful. I'm not writing mid. Mid minus one. I'm not writing till here. I don't want till here. The midpoint is already sorted. I don't want till here. I want only till here. Okay. I want only till 10. So A starts from low up to mid minus 1. What do you call this? Sorting the left part. Okay. Then again, there'll be one more, right? What is that one more? Okay. Be careful here. Again, you are going to write it. A. From where I need to start? Mid. Should I start from mid or mid plus 1? Mid plus 1. Till where? Okay. And what do you call this? This is with regard to the right part sorting. Anything that needs to be done? Yeah, we need to sort of end this if. Anything extra to be done? No. Is that the end of it? Yes. Now you see this? It will be keep on repeatedly sorting the left part. It will be keep on repeatedly doing the right part. At the end, this entire thing is sorted. This right part is sorted. Left part is sorted. Then an entire array is sorted. Okay, entire array is, then it is fully sorted. This is with regard to quick sort. It's a very important problem in second module, because it's a problem that has too many things to be learned. Okay, merge sort, binary search, very minute, very little. This one has more. The next few things which you saw, again very, very minute things only, okay? Small things only that are there with regard to Stassen's matrix, the topological sorting and all, that can be sort of managed. But this, the more aspect of, okay? So this is very important. You need to keep in mind of how things need to be managed with regard to this, okay? What is first thing? The tracing. Second thing, the algorithm. Two algorithms. One for partitioning, one for, of course, merging. This is everything. This probably you'll be seeing even for with regard to merge. Instead of quick sort, you write merge sort. It's the same algorithm. Okay? So you basically know with regard to this. But this is not an end, right? This is not an end. We are going to look for what is known as the next part of it. Now, what is the next part? Next part is always to make sure that why we are in this subject. We are in this subject to sort of analyze the algorithms. Okay. See, what is the purpose of studying all this analysis, everything and all? When you're writing a program, okay, of course, they may call it as algorithm, but when you're writing a program, probably after you go for placements, you know, go for companies and all, you need to always choose the best thing that is possible. How can you make sure that it's the best? By knowing its complexities, by knowing its efficiencies, and that is done using these sort of things. Okay, so we are going to now basically look for what is known as the analysis part of it. Now, what is analysis part? We are going to look for the time complexities, right? Whenever I talk about time complexity, of course, two things comes into picture. What is one thing? Is a substitution method. And the other one is with regard to master's theorem. Two things that needs to be kept in mind. Any one of it should be able to show you. Any one you can always show. When they ask for time complexity, you can use any one of it to show what is the time complexity. Whichever is smaller, whichever is easier for you, that you can use to show you. Now, to find out this time complexity of my quicksort, I can very clearly write this entire recurrence relation, okay, like this. Again, T of n, nothing new. I'm doing the same old thing, okay? Nothing new. If only is equal to fn is equal to n is equal to only 1, you are going to write this as nothing but 0. Very clear that the problem instance will be always divided into two times, right? Two parts, okay? So the recurrence relation for this algorithm can be written as what? 0 if n is equal to 1 and T of n by 2 plus T of n by 2. I'll tell what is it, okay? Probably you'll be knowing by now, but I'll just tell it again, okay? So this is again Cn otherwise. So you can't write this n is equal to 1 here. You should always write towards a place where it is n is equal to 1. Both n is equal to 1 and otherwise should be coming in same place, okay? So this is with regard to what will going to happen when you get time complexity of the quicksort. Okay. But what is this n by 2, n by 2, cn you need to know. Okay. Probably you'll be knowing by now this first n by 2 is to do what? This first n by 2. I'm talking about this one, right? This one is to make sure that what is the time required? This is the time required. Please keep that in mind. Time required to do what? Sorting of what? Left part of the array. Left sort. Then obviously what will be this? This will be the time required for the right sort. What is this? This is very important. This is the time required for what? Again, this is also time because everything is time. This is the time required for what? Partitioning. Partitioning, because that's for the first thing we did, right? It is for the partitioning the array into two parts. You first partition, then only you apply what is known as the sorting technique, right? So you can see very clearly understand that majority of the time happen here. Majority of the time will be taken, majority of the time will be consumed right here because the partitioning itself will be taking a lot of time. So one clue I can give is your time complexity that you are going to calculate will be in terms of your n only.
In terms of your partitioning thing only, it will come.
This is very simplest of thing, right? Time sorting the left part, right part is very minute complex, minute details, minute task. But majority of the task will happen right towards this end. Okay. So if I put this into perspective like this, what I can write? T of n is equal to what you are going to write? You are going to get is a 0. And can write this as 2t of n by 2 plus cn. Okay. I'm not doing anything extra. It's the same old thing. The same old thing what I'm trying to do here. Okay. Now again, what's my next job? My next job is to make sure that I am going to write the entire thing in form of finding out the time complexity. The simplest of thing that you can do with regard to this is with regard to Master's Theorem. Okay. Master's Theorem. So just one second. Okay, sorry for the disturbance. Again, the call from college guys. Okay, yeah. So this is what we got with regard to T of n by, you know, 2T divided by 2T n by 2 plus Cn. Now, you know very clearly what is the thing to be kept in mind. The things we should not forget. The general recurrence relation. Okay, the general recurrence relation of what? Recurrence relation of your divide and conquer technique is given by what? I told you many times. I'm trying to do what is known as Master's Theorem. I'm trying to put the Master's Theorem here to figure out my time complexity. Okay. The general recurrence relation of divide and conquer is given by what? T of n is equal to, be careful here, A T, I've done this many times. Okay. So this is not a new thing. Plus F of n. This is my general recurrence relation for divide and conquer technique. Okay, divide and conquer technique. So for this, what is the thing to be kept in mind? Of course, I'm not going to do anything extra. I'm going to compare this with the relation which I know. What is the relation which I know? Tn is equal to 2tn by 2 plus Cn. So when I compare these two equations, what is the thing I'm going to get? I'm going to get A is equal to 2. Okay. I'm going to get B is equal to 2. I can see very clearly A and A. And then again, you got your B and you got your 2. All other things remain same. Then what's the next thing I get? Okay. F of N is equal to C of this is one thing I know with regard to general recurrence relation of my divide and conquer. What is the next thing I know? What's the next thing I know? The next thing I know is with regard to my Master's Theorem only. Okay. So my Master's Theorem only I know. So I can write that entire Master's Theorem like this. So this is something again you should not forget. Okay. Many times, how many times ever you write, there's always a good probability that you get confused. Okay, so the Master's Theorem with regard to this is given by three conditions. You must be in mind by now. Theta of what? N power of d. Theta of what? N to power of d log p first year and n. Okay, then again theta, be careful here. Okay, now again n to power of, to the power of log b a. Okay, see, many times I'll also get confused with regard to writing this. So unless and until you practice, you keep sum up by it, do anything, you will not remember. Okay, so this is with when a less than b of d, a equal to b of d, a greater than b of d. Here also you should not confuse with this less than becoming greater than, this greater than becoming less than. You should not confuse. Okay, if I do this, now I need to put this value such that I'm able to get what is the time complexity of this. This can be done very easily like this. How? I need to figure out the values of my a, b and all, and of course d. So based on this, what are the values I need to put these values? Okay, see, to apply this equation, now I need to know the value of a. Do I know the value of a? Yes. I need to know the value of b. No, not just b, b to power of d I know. Do I just know this? No, I still don't know what is the value of b to power of d, but I can make out. Okay, how I can make out? I can easily make out from this. Then I can easily put that value towards b here. The same old strategy which we used to do many, many times. Okay, so I can write this entire thing as same thing, f of n is equal to c n. I know this. Can write this entire thing as c n to power of 1. Yes. Can write this entire thing as c. Okay, be careful here. This is very important. C n to power of d, where d value is equal to 1. Okay, where d value is equal to 1, c n to power of 1, c n 2 is nothing but c n. Okay, I can always write like this. So value of d, you know very clearly that is nothing but equal to 1. But b of d needs to be found out. For that, what I do, always same old strategy. I know very clearly b is equal to 2. Okay. Then see, b is equal to 2 right from here. Nothing new. Okay. Now I need to, what is the next thing I do? I will be doing, what is the next step? B to the power of d is nothing but equal to 2 to the power of d.
Correct.
Okay. So what is my next step? What is my next step? B to the power of d is equal to 2 to the power of d. What is b to the power of d? Is b to the power of 1. And what do you think this will be? 2 to the power of 1. Okay. So what is this entire thing with regard to, because d value is nothing but equal to 1. Okay. So what is the thing that you can write? B to the power of d. Now I'll write this as s. What is the value I'll write for b to the power of d? Okay, b to the power of d is nothing but equal to 2. Okay, b to the power of d is nothing but equal to 2. So I got all these things. I got the value of a, I got the value of b to the power of d. Now you can clearly see that what is the most important part? The important part of a is equal to 2, b to the power of d is also equal to 2. Two things that are equal. Okay, two things that are fully sort of equal. Can write this entire thing that a is nothing but equal to b to power of d. If a is equal to b to the power of d, what is the equation to be applied? My equation to be applied is only this. Okay, my equation to be applied is with regard to theta n to power of d log b n. I need to apply that equation. Okay, so to do this, okay, to sort of do this, if I'm able to do this, what is the, you know, sort of time complexity I'm going to get? Okay, see, I'm not doing anything new. I'm going to sort of put that right here. Okay, if I put it right here, t of n will be equal to theta of n t log b and n. What is the value of n to the power of d? N, d value, I know it's 1. Log, what is the value of b? 2. Then n. If I write that into perspective in very simple terms, if I write that, what you are going to get? You are going to get theta of n log 2 n. theta of n log 2 n. This is my Tn. What do you call this? This is nothing but the time complexity. Okay. This is nothing but the time complexity of what? Of my quick sort. And of course, we are talking about the best case. Okay. We are talking about the best case and an average case. The worst case we need to figure out. Okay. This is nothing but the time complexity of my quick sort. Okay. This is what you're supposed to get. This is what you will get. Okay. Very, very important for you to know of how you need to figure out the time complexity of it. See, there are two ways of doing it. One, it's all deducing it, or you yourself biting what is the time complexity of each and everything. Mozart, what is the time complexity? Quicksort, what is the time complexity? Binary search, what is the time complexity? Of course, the next few things that are going to come. Okay. If you are able to do that, then that is also one way, one more way of remembering a thing. But you need to deduce. Nah? Deducing becomes very important. So these small, small tricks, and it remains the same for each and every problem, needs to be kept in. Okay. So this is with regard to time complexity of quicksort. Of course, the best case and even the average case.